Hello, hello, my Parkinson's friends. I'm really excited. It's my pleasure to introduce this really outstanding group of experts to discuss VPS35 mutations and their contribution to Parkinson's disease. I'll also share a fun fact, as we did last time, about each person as I introduce them. In no particular order, first we have Dr. Darren Moore, who is chair and professor in the Department of Neurodegenerative Science and director of the MIND program at Van Andel Institute. If you happen to see Darren at a conference, you can ask him about World War II trivia, and it's always a good, lively discussion, both around the science and the history. Welcome, Darren. Next, we have Dr. Scott Small, who is director of the Alzheimer's Disease Research Center and professor of neurology at Columbia University. Fun fact that I didn't know is Dr. Small recently wrote a book called Forgetting: The Benefits of Not Remembering. And I look forward to reading this, particularly as I get, as aging sets on. Welcome, Dr. Small.
Hello.
Next, we have Dr. Matthew Ferrer, who is professor of neurology and director of clinical genomics program at University of Florida. Fun fact, outside of studying life in the laboratory, Dr. Ferrer enjoys the art of horticulture, most recently adding to his collection with avocado and starfruit trees. Welcome, Matt.
I'm a tree hugger. What can I say? Thank you.
And last but not least, we have Dr. Austin Milnerwood, who is Associate Professor and Director of Integrated Program in Neuroscience Rotation Program at McGill University. Fun fact, I also didn't know this one, Dr. Milnerwood nearly became a military pilot prior to becoming a biologist. Welcome, Austin.
I have to just have my ideas shot at.
Okay, so I will stop sharing the screen here and we can dive right in. So it's been 13 years since the publication of the two papers, one of them by our panel member here, Dr. Matt Ferrer, that implicated VPS35 mutations in Parkinson's disease. So, you know, even before that, there were publications, including publications from Scott, showing the role of VPS35 in retromer, which is the complex that helps with the trafficking of vesicles outside of the endosome to the plasma membrane and then retrograde transport to the Golgi. So, I guess my first question is a hard one. What have we learned in the past 13 years about how these mutations disrupt the retromer complex in VPS35? Scott, maybe you can get us started.
Yeah, thank you. And thank you, Spring, for organizing this. I'm looking forward to learning a lot. I am actually the odd person out here. I'm more of an Alzheimer's guy. But basically, I think so just some quick kind of general principles on retromer and its trafficking pathways. Retromer is actually a complex molecular trafficking machine made up of different components. It's sometimes called a multi-modular machine. At its core is something called the cargo recognition core. It's a heterotrimer made up of VPS35. On either end, you have VPS26 and VPS29. It interacts with other components, so think clathrin, right? Ancillary components, and together they function in regulating two pathways out of the endosome. The recycling pathway, trafficking cargo from the endosome to back to the cell surface, or the retrograde pathway, trafficking cargo from the endosome back to the Transgolgi network. And with that, I think it's easy to explain what we've learned. Although it's interesting how difficult it's been to learn, and I think it's a very subtle mutation, and I would call that subtlety elegant. We've learned a lot about the molecular biochemical effects, a little bit about the cell biology, but as I think you'll hear from everyone, there's a lot of disagreement about what the ultimate effect is on the cell and the brain. So what I think is beyond dispute that the VPS35 mutation disrupts the interaction of VPS35 with one of its core key complexes called the WASH complex. The WASH complex itself is multimeric, and more specifically, VPS35, the mutation disturbs its interaction with FAM21. So that's at the biochemical level. From a cell biological level, a number of, I think, leading investigators in the retromer field have shown that the defect localizes more to the retrograde pathway and not the recycling pathway. And the reason why that's important, a lot of hand movements here, is because the recycling pathway is ultimately in the service of the cell, service of the cell surface, whereas the retrograde pathway is ultimately in the service of the lysosome. And that's why the mutation has shown to cause disturbances in the lysosome. And that's also from Pete Collins and others who are really retromer biologists.
Thanks, Scott. That's a great overview of the retromer complex and the two sides of the pathway. Darren, can I get your thoughts on this, particularly what parts you agree with or disagree with?
Oh, I agree with everything, always. But no, I mean, I think Scott gave a great summary there. I would say the only two things we know for certain, and I think Scott mentioned one of them, is that there's an impairment of WASH complex recruitment by VPS35. That's what one of the the D620M mutation seems to have that impact. What that means, I don't know at this point, or whether it causes or contributes to disease. The other thing I think we're realizing is that the data is fairly robust, is that LOCK2 seems to be activated, when you have a VPS35 mutation. So what that means as well, I think, we're all trying to look at that. We don't know. Why it's activated, we don't know. And so these are the only two things. As for, Scott mentioned the retrograde pathway is more affected. I couldn't at this point pin down a specific retromer cargo that is impaired specifically by the D620N mutation. So I think what we all agree on is this is a really subtle mutation that probably doesn't phenocopy like a loss of retromer function. It's doing something slightly more discrete than that, because those models don't look the same. So I'll stop there.
Austin, you want
to
pitch in?
I'd love to agree with what Scott and Darren have said, and just point one thing out. The question, what have we learned, is a very interesting one, given that it has been about 13 years. Luckily, when Matt and others discovered the mutation in VPS35, unlike other implicated proteins like LERT2, we actually knew a bit about VPS35, although most of it was very retrieval to the Golgi centric, because that is what had been studied at the time. Obviously, Scott had some excellent data implicating it in Alzheimer's disease, but in terms of function, beyond that, we didn't really know much. There was the idea that it might be involved in plasma membrane recycling was starting to become apparent. But what we did find out quite early on is that nobody knew what it did in neurons whatsoever. We didn't know if it had a role at all. And the first thing we did when we looked at it was find that VPS35 is everywhere. It's in axon terminals, it's in dendrites, it's in spines, and there's no trans-Golgi network there. So it looked like it was doing something quite important. And in 10 years, I'd say we've learned a lot about what it does. And in doing so, we've learned to appreciate just how much we really don't know, because the processes involved are extremely complicated. I still have the napkin that Matt and myself sat down and drew VPS35 question mark on. And it does have an endosome, and it does have a lysosome, and it also has a mitochondria, because that is one thing that we did know about at that time, which is the production of peroxisomes for mitochondria. It could be affecting lysosomes through a mitochondrial sensing route. It can be affecting lysosomal and endosomal recycling in a very neural specific way, which I would posit. So a synaptic vesicle is a specialized endosome, and it's tightly linked to lysosomal sorting. So we think that would be important. And just to finally, before I shut up, to back up what Darren said, in terms of what the mutation does, I think it's fairly clear now that we don't think it's a loss of function. And Matt just published another paper comparing haploinsufficiency to the mutation. We found out very early on that the effects of knockout, a lethal overexpression, is complicated, but it showed that it didn't look like we've just lost function. Although the other thing we can all agree on is that FAM21 binding does seem to be reproducible in many different contexts.
Thanks, Austin. And of course, Matt, I want to get your thoughts, particularly coming back As Austin mentioned, I also remember I was in the lab at that time, and I remember you and Carlos kind of putting that on the board and saying, what do we know about VPS 35 and where do we go from here? But now 13 years later, and Austin touched on some of the other things besides the retrograde trafficking, which of course we'll talk about LRP 2. What do we know about the whole, everything else that was just mentioned? I definitely want to talk about some of the effects of the synapse, some of the effects on mitochondria, and whether we do think that it is necessarily the retrograde trafficking because there's overlap with LRP2, and we'll talk more in detail on LRP2. But Matt, bring it home for us and put it all together.
That's right. I've got a lot of experts here, and more expert than me. I see things through an evolutionary kind of genetic lens, and I stay focused there. The one thing I would mention is the pleiotropic roles of VPS35 and LRK2 and all of these genes in any gene, any protein involved in biology. There's a plethora of cargos, for example, the interactions with nexins with different membranes. There's a tremendous amount of biology going on. And I think we've really got to focus on what's relevant, what's important to disease pathogenesis. And it may be different to what's relevant to disease etiology. And that's something that we could debate or talk about. I don't know if you want to elaborate. I can elaborate on that. But if people understand what I mean, the etiology of these diseases may be different. The reason these mutations have arisen, evolutionarily speaking, is different to the pathogenesis of the disease. And whichever rabbit hole we're going to go down, they're all valuable and all useful enterprises. I think patients would prefer us to go down looking for roots to pathogenesis and understanding that. But the biology is really complicated. And not only is it cargo specific, but it's also potentially cell specific. And of course, it's networked as well. So there's a lot going on. So I'll leave it at that. I've got my personal favorites, but if you want.
What do you think about the haploinsufficiency versus, let's say, the knock-in of the mutation, Matt?
Do you agree? We published a paper on that recently, yep. which I think is a really elegant piece of work, but it was trying to make lemonade out of a lemon. We originally made a conditional knock-in mouse by putting in a mini gene cassette into intron 14. And in the process, and we engineered in the mutation at the same time, but in the process, we managed to make that allele haploinsufficient. We managed to knock out the expression. So we basically have two mice born from the same mother, one that's haploinsufficient, 50% reduced activity, and one that is the D620N knock-in mutation. And we thought we'd compare their biology. And we looked, under the lamp, looked at dopamine, and dopamine biology, and focused on that particular cell type, thinking, the Parkinson's community might think that has a relevance to their disease. And we found some very interesting observations in terms of differences between haplomice and Vicky mice, and published that in December last year. Some of those things include basic biochemistry. Some of it is to do with measurements of dopamine physiology. The release and reuptake of dopamine from brain slices. And we found some very different biology going on in those mice. And we also managed to induce behavior, differences in behavior with amphetamine in the animals, given their DAT biology is very different. DATs, the dopamine transporter, is a VPS35 cargo, and it's recycled basically in dopaminergic terminals. And that recycling is impaired in the VPS35 mice. And it's regulated in part by LRK2 kinase activity. And the autophagy of that is controlled by LRK2 kinase activity. So I think, to me, that's part of the heart of the matter, is looking at the machinery in the cell type that potentially matters. Microglia are also important. Shout out to my...
Yep. And so I wonder, and this would be the transport of DAT to the cell surface would be part of the recycling side of things, right? So Scott, I wonder if you can comment on that, since there are differences seen on that side versus what's considered as the main side, which is the retrograde to the trans Golgi.
Yeah, no, man, and I think we're all being a little polite here. You know, there are disagreements, and I actually don't have a. I love the Dat story. It as Matt says, it's relevant. What Pete Cullen has worked on are, you know, immortalized cells, and we all know that they are interesting to study cell biology, but they might not be most relevant. The pathways are not discrete. It's not all or none. They're both implicated. Certainly when you impair VPS35, which is really the backbone of the whole machine. I think the analysis is really interesting. I would, you know, one of the things maybe we'll talk about is there are DAT scans in patients. I don't know if it's true. Am I the only clinician here? So, you know, the idea of trying to go into humans as soon as possible, talking to Michael J. Fox, because I do have some VPS35 patients. Can we do DAT scans and actually bring it back, as you nicely say, Matt, to the human condition? So I'm open to everything. And I think it's a great story if it pans out.
And I do want to get back to, I think we're all interested in human. Obviously, the models are great because we have to study the human. And this is such a rare set of genetic mutations that you sort of, there's limited availability of human data, right? Actually, last week, Shalini was mentioning that there's an effort going on, Scott, you're nodding, with Dario and Zimprish and Christine Klein's group to try to collect more information from VPS35 mutation carriers, including PBMCs, CSF, you know, looking at potentially alpha-synuclein seed assay in those. Do we know, as far as one question that came up last week that was sort of left unanswered, is around the pathology that's observed in these patients. I don't know if anybody, I'm please just speak up. Does anybody know what the pathology looks like in these patients? Do we see synuclein? Do we see tau?
I will let someone else clarify this for me, but I believe, you know, there aren't that many cases, so there aren't that many path reports, but I think the first versions, maybe Matt, now you know this, I think they were reporting that there's relatively less alpha-synuclein pathology. Is that right?
Yeah. I haven't got an update on pathology lately from anybody that I work with, but the one case that's published, unfortunately, didn't have a midbrain. It's just cortical material for the most part, and there was no living pathology in it. So the jury's still out, I'm afraid, really, in terms of pathology. I mean, in human individuals, but there's lots of report. Darren can probably talk to this best, perhaps, about tauopathy and in rodent models. There's some reports of synucleinopathy in rodent models too, depending on the type of model that you've used. It might be pleomorphic, like LERC2, which wouldn't particularly surprise me at the end of the day. It's what I'd expect. Whether seeding assays for synuclein are useful in LERC2 patients, sorry, in LERC2 patients too, for that matter, but in VPS35 patients, I beg to differ, probably.
Darren, do you want to comment about the animal model?
Yeah, sure. I mean, just going back to what Matt said, I guess what we do know is there's no, in the one case that's been autopsied, there's no synuclein pathology outside of the brainstem, right? So that's one case, but we know it's not, you know, got cortical Lewy body pathology. So whether it has midbrain pathology, I have no idea. In mice, I mean, we can talk about all the different models out there, but I can just summarize and say they don't really show robust pathology. That's definitely a theme. We're thinking about alpha-synuclein. In our hands, we can't see any pathology, you know, in very sort of well-aged mice, 18 months and above. We do see some sort of tau pathology, but it's modest. It's not like it's everywhere. And it's also not tangle pathology, as we would think about in Alzheimer's. It's more pre-tangle-like, and it's in the stoma. So that's not really pathology. That's just a redistribution of tau, and it's picking up some epitopes and sitting in the stoma away from the axon. So that's definitely happening in our mice. Some people have replicated that, so that's good. There are some people who say there's synuclein pathology, but I'm not a huge believer at this point. I haven't seen anything that I would say is aggregated synuclein there's sometimes a small increase in synuclein expression based on most people's studies, but no real kind of like phosphoserine 129 alpha synuclein deposits or inclusions. So, I mean, they don't have that kind of frank pathology that you would expect, like you know, most animal models outside of just an alpha synuclein mouse. So, yeah, that's kind of where we are, I think.
Makes sense. Austin,
I'd
you had
like
a
to
comment?
Interject and again mostly agree with Darren, but whilst we don't yet know what the pathology in the brain of the families affected is like, the clinical manifestation suggests that the same circuits are definitely disturbed. It would be remarkable to get such a strong concordance with LRRK2 and other forms of Parkinsonism, idiopathic or otherwise, if it was completely separate. So those circuits seem to be affected, which I think is a standout thing. And the other thing, when we take into account mechanisms and pathology, what we have to ignore in a lot of cases because of the kind of models we use is age. And we know that whatever is happening in VPS35, it's taking 60 years to manifest as a symptom. So any, you know, massive change to VPS35 biology is either tolerated or not a problem until something else changes in an old brain. And whilst we might not see, you know, huge holes in the heads of mice up to, I think about 16 months is probably the eldest published. I know Matt and myself, when we looked up to 18 months, we didn't see a whole degree of pathology. But if you look at the age of a C57 Black 6 mouse at 13 to 18 months, it's about 50. And so what we've been trying to assess recently is aging those little mice out to the age at which other indications suggest they would be 60 to 70 years of age, which is about 25, 26 months, which is a long time to wait. But I think we might find out a lot more about the long-term effects in terms of, you know, cell loss of pathology if we push them a bit further.
Of course,
I can just quickly say we have aged them out to 24 months. We haven't published it, but we still don't see anything that looks like synuclein pathology. So, I mean, you know.
Do you see an increase? Do you see
more
cell
money.
Death? Sorry.
Cell death? No, I mean, not really.
So it's stable from 13, 14 onwards? So.
Yeah.
And okay, so this is maybe not itself. Terribly surprising given the, you know, LRRK2 mouse models as well. And I do want to come back to LRRK2. I know we're all excited to talk about the convergence with LRRK2. And by the way, Austin, you mentioned that the similarities between LRRK2 PD and idiopathic PD, and maybe let's discuss those kind of separately as well, because is LRRK2 PD necessarily reflective of idiopathic PD? But there's a question in the chat that I would like to ask. Based on this coming from Malu Tanzi, based on the NSC framework, would we then call VPS35 mutation-related pathology Parkinson's? And as a follow-up, is the NSC framework going to emphasize and take into consideration the cell type and brain region location of synuclein? I don't know if anybody wants to take that question.
I think she's asking for trouble.
Who knows? I wouldn't say we don't know if it has pathology, right? One case. So it could well be a synucleopathy. Who knows? You know, the humans, obviously. The mouse models don't replicate that. I don't think the NSD criteria are really getting at cell type at this point, right? I don't think they're we don't have the tools to do that. Only post-mortem, I would imagine, but I don't know. So anybody else, Matt?
I was actually going to ask you about seeding and spreading assays for synuclein and for tau, and your experience of those with VPS35 animals, because maybe that's part of the equation here, that if we will leave it long enough, we maybe see more of, you know, these exogenous material in seeding and spreading in whether that pathology, I mean, it's associated with the condition, but it's certainly not causal, it's secondary. To answer Malu's comment, I think about that way all the time with pathology. You know, it's the tombstone. It's not necessarily the cause of death. It's rarely the cause of death. So it's interesting nonetheless, and it does cause. It's associated with perhaps more severe acute disease. I don't know. I'd be curious to have a debate on pathology. I'm an etiologist.
Ditto. I don't think we don't have any pathologists on the call, unfortunately. Might have to get Dennis on to school us on that front. Scott, did you have any thoughts on the pathology or you know, whether to categorize this in the realm of just Parkinson's?
I don't want to invoke my outsider's card, but I what I'm hearing here resonates with my insider's card on Alzheimer's, the debate about proteinopathies, are they tombstones, are they drivers, are they pathogenic? And it is interesting to me that I've learned from my colleagues here and others, as I've been sucked into the Parkinson's field because of Retromer, that the mouse models are notoriously bad, or not bad, they're more difficult to phenocopy the human condition compared to Alzheimer's, where we do see at least plaques, we occasionally see tangles. So it's an interesting compare and contrast. And I gather from your overview, at some point we'll talk about the compare and contrast. So I have no opinion about Malou's excellent question, but I have opinions on the compare and contrast.
And so maybe let's very quickly talk about Alzheimer's before we jump into the convergence with LRRK2, which is VPS35, at least expression levels have been implicated in Alzheimer's. And I've also seen some data on PSP. Can you comment on that, Scott? Where do you see the differences as far as Alzheimer's versus Parkinson's when it comes to the Retromer?
Well, to me, and I'm very interested, and I would at some point, Matt, like to talk about the difference between etiology and pathogenesis. To me, we used to be called natural philosophers, and we become technocrats. That's a philosopher's question, which I live and breathe. The way I see it is that you rely on a pathogenic gene to link a pathway to a disorder, and the canonical is LDL receptor to hypercholesterolemia. No one developed drugs. No one stopped at LDL receptor. We did the hard work to find the pathway, cholesterol metabolism, that generalizes. And that's basically what I've tried to do with Alzheimer's. The pathway's been implicated by gene expression, but I think its etiological link is anchored most heavily in SORL1, which I think everyone acknowledges now is the fourth causal gene in Alzheimer's, and it's heavily linked to Alzheimer's disease. It creates these beautiful scaffolds. When it comes to Parkinson's, the link to Retromer is more immediate, VPS35, but even there, I would argue, let's think of pathways and not get caught up on the specific molecule, and let's try to work hard to extract a generalizable pathways from these rare mutations.
Perfect segue to going into LRRK2, actually, because I think there's quite a bit of overlap. We've seen VPS35 mutations activate the LRRK2 pathway. So one could argue that given the overlap between those two, the parts of the pathway that are overlapped between VPS35 and LRRK2 may be more important for disease etiology than some other things that may also be affected by LRRK2 or VPS35 independently of one another. So with that, let's open up the LRRK2. Who should I start with? Everybody, I think everybody's worked on the convergence of VPS35 and LRRK2. Austin, maybe you can get us started this time.
It's a great little question with a large set of answers. I think what is abundantly clear is that a lot of uncontrovertible LRRK2 substrates have a higher level of phosphorylation in the presence of the D620N mutation. And I think some of the earliest attempts to explain that with VPS35 activating LRRK2 have given us a really good framework to interrogate, but clearly it's not that simple. I think it's in terms of a lot of our understanding has leapt from looking at VPS35 in the context of LRRK2 in the immune system, because those cells have a huge bandwidth for LRRK2 activation. But if we look at just brain tissue, and we find those LRRK2 substrates are phosphorylated, they're hyperphosphorylated in VPS35 mutant scenarios. But when we eliminate the activity of LRRK2 pharmacologically, at least over a small scale, that hyperphosphorylation drops to the same level as the wild type. It doesn't go below that. So this makes me think that it's really not that simple, and whatever is driving the increase in the substrates is not as simple as VPS35 mutations kickstarting LRRK2. But you know, that said, there's so much data coming out now. I think Dario dropped two. There's other labs bringing in implications of the mutation changes Lurk2's localization, which probably helps it phosphorylate its substrates more. And even some of the things that we thought were its substrates, such as Rab12, may be playing that intermediate role between VPS35 mutations and Lurk2.
Interesting perspective, and I think a little bit different that. This part, I think, is a bit different depending on who you talk to, right, as far as how the two converge. Does everybody agree that the two converge? Can we agree on that part?
They're Lurk2 in cells. At some point, they're doing similar stuff.
They're in cells. A little bit more than that, maybe.
I think we all agree that we all see Rab phosphorylation in our D620N knock-in models. That's everybody has that data. I think everybody here has published that work. So that we can say for certain. What that means, I think, is, you know, up for debate.
So, Darren, what do you think that means?
Oh, I don't know.
Yes, you do.
I mean, we work on that very exact, that same question. I think I'm thinking right now, you know, it's all about lysosomal stress. So I think Lurk2 is responding to a very unique form of lysosomal stress, and we have data kind of suggesting that in different brain cell types. So VPS35 isn't really activating Lurk2 directly. It's causing a unique form of lysosomal damage, which is not like the other forms you see with lysoosmotropic agents, and Lurk2 is responding to that damage. That's why it's activated. And, you know, we're going to submit that soon, but that's what I think. I think drugging Lurk2 perhaps will not have much impact on VPS35 linked disease.
Can I just actually step in and say, first of all, I hear that Malo's on the call. She knows that I don't play the false modesty card very well, but I am really delighted to learn from these experts here. And I am particularly delighted that Darren just said that, because I want to highlight the importance of integrative biology of everyone, the geneticists, the animal modelers, the clinicians working together, because this is exactly what happened at a Royal Society meeting dedicated to endosomal trafficking that Darren participated in, many others did, Dario did, Mark Cookson did. And it led to a discussion that led to a review paper where Dario was the first author, I'm the last author, where we exactly introduced this as an idea. Because what was so interesting to me was, I think everyone acknowledges the work. I think Dario has led that. I apologize if others have. That's the biggest problem when you're an outsider. You step on toes unintentionally. When I step on toes intentionally, that's fine. But the idea that it's upstream to Lurk2, clearly connected, but also there's no physical interaction. And so it's a classic cell biological interaction. And then Mark Cookson, of course, and others have established that lysosomal stress will recruit Lurk2 to the, will translocate Lurk2 from the cytosol to the lysosomal membranes, phosphorylate Rabs. And in our discussions, we were saying, well, you know, those manipulations that Mark and others used are either non-specific, non-physiologic, and you can't say that anything that causes lysosomal stress would do that, because then there'd be a lot more causes for Parkinson's. So we actually introduced this idea that retromer, the VPS35 mutation, is causing a very specific kind of lysosomal stress that's then recruiting it. And it was just a hypothesis, a framework that hopefully we could, and others could test or refute. So I'm delighted, Darren, that we're thinking alike, because I really look to people like you and others on this call to vet my ideas that are often young and inchoate.
Right. Yeah, as Darren was speaking, I was thinking of Scott, the figure that is in that publication you mentioned with Dario, that shows it pretty much exactly that. Sounds like that side is on the same page. Austin and Matt, are we in agreement as well that, you know, it's really the lysosomal stress that is triggering ALRT2 and maybe VPS35 just contributes to the lysosomal stress by maybe mislocalization of some of the cargo that's supposed to not go that way?
I think it's very, very, very reasonable. Very, very reasonable indeed. And it's not how I see it, but it's very reasonable. And VPS35 D620N is probably the best activator of ALRT2 kinase in a sense. And we don't quite know why or how. We can generalize and say it's cargo mistrafficking or lysosomal stress and because of that. But it's not the only one. And there are other things that cause, obviously, ALRT2 kinase activation. And I think that's where I'd like to focus and maybe frame the conversation. This is these mutations have arisen, evolutionary speaking, in innate intracellular immune response to basically dampen down pathogens that are invading our immune systems. And nature has clumsily come along and broken its machine in a variety of different ways and put in ALRT2 mutations, VPS35 mutations, PINK1 mutations, Parkin mutations, etc., basically to compromise the same system. And that etiology, I think, is really, really critical, not necessarily to pathogenesis, but to understanding the machine, the molecular machine, basically, and having a blueprint of that on how these component parts actually work together, potentially to cause the disease. But that's the bit we've got to resolve now. Does etiology, is that the same thing as pathogenesis?
I'd like to add to what Matt said there is that the cells in our bodies all live with a pathogen. We our mitochondria, yeah, within our cells were not there before we became eukaryotes. And the way that we sense or our cells sense that presence, it have turned it in from checking out something that shouldn't be there to being a way of sensing the health of the cell and the environment and all of the bits in it, which it does through VPS35 on mitochondria and endosomes and lysosomes for 65 years. That is definitely the one thing that brings all of this together, whether we think there are distinct mechanisms, and they're all sat in the same system in the cell.
And this is great, actually, because it goes into something that we haven't really talked about much, which is mitochondria and the mitolysosome side of things as well, which you all know I have a special place in my heart for. By the way, there is a poll out. Please, if you'd like to answer whether ALRT2-centric therapies are likely to have potential for VPS35-mediated PD. I know Darren already kind of addressed this, but I guess depending on how you think ALRT2 is downstream of VPS35 might change the answer to that question.
But are we allowed to answer the poll ourselves as well?
I don't think the panel is going to answer. It's only for the attendees, but you're welcome to give your opinion live.
I wouldn't want to bias it.
Well, Darren already did, so go ahead. No, okay, we'll touch base on it at the end. But let's go back to mitochondria, and we do see some deficits in mitochondria. There is convergence on the immune side of things, Austin, as you mentioned. Does anybody else think about mitochondria, and what do you think about it? Obviously, we do see other genetic mutations that are in that part of the pathway. We do see mitochondria affected, questionable whether it's direct or indirect, even in the ALRT2 mutation carriers. So what are we thinking on that side?
Could I make the question more pointed, because this came up in the ADPD meeting and I don't know what the true answer is. I truly am asking without knowledge, isn't it true that the mutations that are linked to mitochondria, I mean, I know the biological potential link, but phenotypically, aren't the mitochondrial driven genes, don't they present much earlier than the VPS35 mutation? So then how could it be linked?
Well, one thing that I would, sorry to answer.
No, you're part of the discussion, Spring.
But one thing that I would encourage people to think about is if the mitochondrial deficits are kind of the end, the last step before you have neurodegeneration, wouldn't you expect that they would present earlier onset than some of these other things that have to go through multiple steps before they get to the mitochondrial dysfunction? And also you don't have, with the mitochondrial, perhaps synuclein, it's been shown to be, although this is again arguable, upstream. So you don't have the push from synuclein to, you know, kind of cause further, because they're also slower progressing, right? Whether that's age related or related to the additional pathologies that are not coming along with it, because it's downstream, right? But I'm curious to hear what everybody else thinks. It's just one opinion.
I think I generally agree with, if mitochondria is one of the endpoints and you have a mitochondrial mutation, that might manifest early, but it's not particularly progressive. It's not as aggressive. You can live with, you know, pink one Parkinsonism for some time. I'm not the clinician, so I shouldn't really say that, but to my understanding.
I'm just going to come back to the biology and say that, you know, nobody is really saying that mitophagy is altered in VPS35 animal models at this stage. It could be. We're saying there are mitochondrial deficits in some of those systems. Typically, though, with overexpression, I think you're finding a lot more mitochondrial problems with overexpression and maybe knockout completely of VPS35. Not necessarily in the kind of physiological knock-in model. But I guess we know that VPS35 from Heidi McBride's work has some role in mitochondrial-derived vesicle generation. But what I always keep hearing from the retroma guys, including Scott and Pete Cullen, is that VPS35 does not localize to mitochondria under any circumstances. That much, I think the retroma community tends to be, you know, they don't see the evidence for it. So they you know, that. So I'm learning too, right? But I would add to that.
It's not a clear association, but it very much depends where you look. Not many people look at mitochondria in axons, never mind, you know.
I completely agree with that. And if I could, talk about our review, it was actually Dario who suggested that we image the mice and to ask the question that was alluded to earlier, which cell type. I think you really need to know which brain region first. And that's what our mouse imaging are very good for. I know there's a little bit of pushback because there's no clear phenotype behaviorally. But our imaging tools have gotten so sensitive that we can see things even without clear behavioral phenotypes. And whether we can or cannot, I think the principle is right, that if you can really, and this is Dario advocating it, let's just image them over time, find where we find the defect first and foremost, microdissect that area. And I completely agree with Austin and others, we might be surprised. Maybe there, VPS35 is localized to the mitochondria. I mean, I don't think so, but that's the outstanding question in my mind. And which cell type?
Thanks to Dario for pushing that. I do think that's a good, important experiment. I will also launch another poll about the role of VPS35 in various pathways. So if you're an attendee, please contribute to that. So let's talk about cell types. That's come up a few times. Neurons, glia, where are we sitting on that? Darren, you want to get us started?
No, not really. But
you agreed to be on the panel.
I guess if we look at humans, right, they all have dopaminergic cell loss, so we can't ignore that. There's often some, whether that's cell autonomous or non-cell autonomous, it's happening, right? So that's an important cell type. I think we see VPS35 everywhere. You know, that everyone has their favorite cell type, but it is truly expressed in astrocytes, microglia, most neurons. I think if you look in, the knock-in mouse, you know, they have tau pathology across the brain in different neuronal cell types. I don't know what that means yet, but like they certainly, you know, there's no preference at this point. Actually, the hippocampus seems to be most affected. We have, we're working on data that says there's a pretty major role for VPS35 in astrocytes, and especially the D620N mutation. Whether that's driving disease or sufficient to drive disease, we don't yet know. So I think it could be one of those complicated answers where everything might be involved at different stages, but I just don't know yet.
So one thing that's striking to me is, most people agree that there is some overlap between the VPS35 and LRRK2 pathways. But then when you talk about cell types, it's kind of wildly different. You mentioned astrocytes, it rarely gets talked about with LRRK2. A lot of talk about microglia. Curious if anybody else has opinions on the cell types.
Well, I could just tell you that in Alzheimer's, it's a little easier because you can rely on the fact that there is complexity even at the heterotrimer. So VPS26 has two paralogs, B and A. VPS26B has been more heavily linked to Alzheimer's. It unlike the other components of retromer, is differentially localized to neurons in the cortex. So that helps. But if you're dealing with VPS35, Darren, of course, is right. It's really diffuse. There's no clues onto from VPS35 itself. I've once played the game on the FAM21. Maybe that could, but that too is diffusely expressed. So I think it's a physiology experiment, not a gene expression experiment.
So I just to back up what's already been said, we know that VPS35 has roles in just about every cell type. And if you're looking from a LERC2 perspective, there's lots going on in peripheral cells. But the inescapable fact is that, you know, those cells have a short half-life compared to the cells that are the resident information processes in the brain. And if you've got a small problem that's going on for a long time, that might be why you see neural vulnerability. The mechanisms could be the same in every single cell type. They could be specific in every cell type. But, you know, at the end of the day, the cells that have to deal with this for decades are not microglia.
Interesting perspective. I hadn't heard it phrased like that before.
I'd agree with that.
That's why I won't be invited next time.
You're always invited. A question from the chat from an anonymous person, just to touch on a previous conversation about how age is a factor and symptoms of disease show only at older age. Is there any evidence to show that in VPS35 or in pathogenic mutations in other genes, development or physiology is altered at a younger age at possibly undetected levels before the full manifestation of the disease? And as a follow-up, can the panelists speak to VPS35's proposed involvement in the Wnt beta-catenin pathway and how that may contribute to PD? Up for grabs for anyone.
Wow. I can start maybe. Is there evidence of something prodromal happening, I guess? I think it's impossible to know. I don't see how we can even answer that question unless we image people with mutations prior to disease onset. In animal models, they seem to be progressive as well. So it's not like they're born with deficits or tau pathology or dopaminergic cell loss. It progresses over time. So I don't know, this is a late onset disease, right? You know, for VPS35, similar to idiopathic. So clearly age is a factor there, but I like that idea that some of this, you know, you could be born with less dopaminergic neurons or some vulnerability, but I don't think any of us really have the evidence for that.
And I'd like to interject a little there, Darren. I think there's lots of evidence that the mutation does stuff at very early stages in the animal models and certainly in the cells. I seem to be listening to myself there, sorry. You know, protein interactions are altered from the get-go. When we look at network formation and activity, that's altered from the get-go. Not necessarily in the same direction as that which will give you proteinopathy and cell death, you know, a long time later. But, you know, there was it's a long time ago now, someone controversially put out a review on neuroarchaeology, such that changes that occur during development may have no detrimental effects until, you know, the brain starts to age. And depending on how it's wired and how it was functioning early on, that could well contribute.
That's a good point, Austin. And, LRRK2 activation starts from birth, right? You can look in MEFs, you can look in very young animals, and they have massive LRRK2 activation already at birth. So they can tolerate that, it seems, for quite a long time.
I would just add to that as well, the human neuron studies, of which there are now quite a few. I think a lot of people are seeing differences in D620N human neurons. Now, the process of making those and the stress of them growing and trying to act like a neuron in a dish for a long time is hard to dissect from, you know, the late onset disease, but there certainly are quite clear changes that seem to be quite consistent in things like neurite outgrowth and mitochondrial function and lysosomal as well. So the changes are there from the start.
I think there's a lot of different features. Parkinson's is not a dichotomous trait, not black and white. It's not one day you got it and one day you don't. Maybe you have a diagnosis one day, but and the day before you didn't, but the disease manifests in insidious ways for decades prior to getting a diagnosis. We all know that for idiopathic PD. It's the same for VPS35 Parkinson's too. So the disease process is ongoing for a very, very long time prior to any noticeable manifestation. I was really intrigued that the mice that we first made and showed dopaminergic deficits in the mice had no movement disorder. You know, we can see dopaminergic changes with slices, with stimulation, but we couldn't see any movement disorder in the animal. The compensation is incredible. The ability of the
mice will put up with so much. But if you look at the amount of the dopamine system you have to ablate to get a motor phenotype, it's everybody seems to assume that if you have a dysfunctional dopamine neuron, you're going to see a motor phenotype. But you can get rid of 90% of it and you won't. Yeah. Anyway, so yeah, so just to back up.
Mice are the right system to go into. I mean, as you said, Austin, like you can wipe out with something like MPTP quite a large number of cells and still not see motor deficits. So,
but then you know that is probably what we see in the humans as well.
If
70% of nigral terminals by the time they're shaking in the clinic, and there's a lot going on before that. Sorry, Scott, I did not mean to interrupt.
No, it's okay. Back to the you know, the philosophical. Everyone here, and this is something we deal with most neurodegenerative diseases, is it time or is it aging? And they're not the same thing. In other words, Vogelstein has a really elegant paper in Science on a lot of cancer genes, that it's just stochastic. In other words, time will cause things to, you know, break down over time. Or is there something specific about the aging physiology that layers on to the pathophysiology? So, for example, if it's time alone, Benjamin Button will develop the disease as he ages. If it's aging, he'll be born with the disease. And, you know, these are not just philosophical mind games. I think it's critical. Because I've heard people say that aging is the main contributing factor to neurodegeneration. I actually think it's more the stochastic time and not just aging. And I think that's an important distinction.
Scott, any way to do any experiment you can think of to differentiate between that? Because with aging, you know, you do get that in a lot of cellular pathways, like lysosomal dysfunction, mitochondrial dysfunction. So can you think of a good experiment to actually test that?
I've been thinking a lot about this, and I've been talking to people from the, like, you know, more deeper thinkers than I, and the Chen Zuckerberg, because these are, you can model it in different ways. That's what Vogelstein did. It's not easy, obviously. If something is linear over time, it's more likely to be stochastic, but that doesn't, you know, a physiological process can also be linear, but typically physiological processes are nonlinear. So, you know, it gets into that kind of modeling, and which is heavily anchored in assumptions, which might be wrong. So I can't, if any of your listeners, if anyone else here has ideas, I'd love to try to disambiguate those two.
Well, I wonder if you can kind of reset the age, you know, with the like iPSCs, how you, when you kind of reset them back to embryonic, if you can kind of get rid of some of the aging side of things. But I don't know, again, if you can reintroduce time somehow. Certainly not that long. But anyway, just a thought. We only have 5 minutes, and I do want to make sure we get to talking about therapeutics. So there haven't been really any, there have been multiple LRRK2-centric therapies in development, as far as I know, and there have been some challenges. Are you aware of any VPS-35-related therapeutics that are in development? Nothing in clinical
So maybe I can start, because by way of transparency, I don't think it's a conflict, but people should know that Greg Petzko and I have co-founded a company called Retromer Therapeutics, but it's mainly focused on Alzheimer's disease. And I think the compare and contrast is interesting. I hear from everyone that no one would necessarily want to give a VPS-35 enhancer if it's truly a toxic gain of function. I'm sidestepping the debate about whether it's a gain of function or not. I think that sometimes falls apart. You know, presenilin is a loss of function genetically, but it's a toxic gain of function. Any beta 42, I will agree with everyone here that it's doing something bad, the mutation. The one thing that we've observed, and we haven't pursued this therapeutically, is when we've been looking at AAV9s, when we use AAV9 wild type VPS-35 injected to the substantia nigra of the D2 into the PD mutants, we get a replacement. In other words, the endogenous VPS-35 gets downregulated and the wild type VPS-35 dominates. Therapeutically, that's a beautiful idea, but it's far from really translating to therapeutics.
Very interesting. That was a question from Olga Krylova, by the way. I forgot to mention. One other question, a couple more questions in the chat. One from Warren Hurst. How does the disease progress in patients with VPS-35 mutations? LRRK2G2019S progress more slowly, in quotation marks. Are VPS-35 mutation carriers like these?
I think it's a little bit more aggressive, but marginally so.
More penetrant, for sure.
It's more penetrant, and I don't know. There's I mean, the best paper is that Steger paper from I think it's 2014 or so. It's quite a while ago now, but it was a study on something like 60 patients with VPS5 mutations, and I'm sure Darren's probably read it. That's where I get my data from. But hopefully the LUC2 cohort consortium that they're building around VPS35 can address some of that. It would be interesting to hear about more about the cognitive side of things, and there's not a lot of data.
Another question from Malou, which was, what about an experiment? I think going back to what we were just talking about, differentiating between aging and time. What about an experiment where you put in VPS35 mutations in a mouse model of aging, like DNA pol mice? And Darren, I don't know if you want to comment publicly.
Yeah, I answered Malou directly, but yeah, we're doing that experiment as part of our ASAP team that we have, looking at DNA damage driven by ERCC1 deletion, and using that as a sort of a model of cellular senescence and advanced aging, and you know, crossing that with the VPS35 NOKINs to see if we can unmask phenotypes or accelerate phenotypes, and the opposite experiment as well. You know, treating those mice with Xenolytics to see if we can remove some of the pathology. So yeah, that's a big part of the ASAP senescence team that we have. Yeah.
Right. So aging models can be used as well. Yep. Great. Yeah, that's a great idea, Malou. And Darren, of course, you'd already thought about it. One more minute here. So we'll just get any final comments from our panelists. Thank you so much again for joining us. But any last words on VPS35 and PD?
I would like to say that we're learning so much about these proteins and what they do that if we can't join up all the dots, it's going to push the field in the right direction anyway. And given that this 13 years sounds like a long time, that's like two consecutive PhDs. So I think considering how little time you can actually have put into it in the last 13 years, I think the progress is being made, quite a lot of progress.
Well, add though that 13 years is a long time if you're a patient. So
yes, absolutely.
I agreed with you, but yep.
So more funding and more push. Let's see what we can do to help.
And thank you to all of you for doing VPS35 because, you know, there's so much more being done on the LRRK2 and GBA and some of the other genetic mutations. But I think each of the genetic mutations, no matter how rare, can give us clues as to what's actually happening in the disease process.
I'll say thank you to you, Spring, because to my point, it's not just more funding, it's more integration. We need to integrate everyone on this call. And I know that happens in the conferences, but the more we do that, I think the more we'll connect dots, not just astrologically, but astronomically.
Awesome. Well, thank you all for joining the panel. Lovely to see you all. And I hope that we can integrate some of these with the other panels that are coming up and the LRRK2 panel that has passed. All right.
Thanks so much for inviting us.
Have a good rest of your day.
Sounds good.